Welcome to worship. We're glad that you could join us today. We have just a couple of announcements. You know, we're in Lent. This is our Lenten season. So on Wednesdays, we send out an email that has a link to a 15-minute contemplative worship. We hope that you'll take advantage of this midweek experience and watch that worship. Send that link around to friends, neighbors, family members. Help us spread the word and let's help draw other people into these contemplative midweek experiences. Also on that Wednesday email is the full week of Lenten devotions. We have wonderful people who've been writing these devotions and we hope that you'll read them. Our focus this year is on choose love, choose hope. And so folks are writing about experiences they've had where they or someone else chose love, chose hope in that situation. We hope those are a blessing to you. Also, we're getting ready to have our Abiding Hope's Got Talent event at the beginning of April. And this event is to raise money to send our teens on servant tour this summer. And one kiddo needs $500 of support, each kiddo. So if you want to pay for one kid to have this experience, it's $500. But we need to raise $20,000. And so we hope that you'll be generous in helping us put a kid on the bus to have this life-changing summer experience. Our kids don't go to amusement parks. They go to serve. They go to pour themselves out. This isn't just a fun. They'll have fun. You know they have fun. But they're going to help and serve and recognize their identity as children of God. So also, we're looking for folks who have talent who want to participate in the Abiding Hope's Got Talent. So if you're interested in doing that, then contact the church office and we'll get you on the list of participants. But please be generous and let's support our youth in their work. Now let's prepare for worship.
Gonna fade away. We are the free, and yours is the glory.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Creator God, we thank you for life. We thank you for blue skies and the sounds of birds. We thank you for the sound of children laughing and playing. We thank you for our own lives and the opportunity to experience love, to experience goodness, to experience grace. We thank you that you have created us and placed us in this world. But Lord, we're broken. Life is hard, and all of us experience abandonment. We experience rejection. We experience betrayal, all sorts of things that wound us, that break us. And sometimes out of our wounds, we inadvertently wound others. Well, sometimes we actually intend to wound others, and we're sorry. Forgive us, Lord. We're broken people, and we need your grace. And so help us as we go forward in living in this world, help us to include one another. Help us to forgive one another. Give us the faith and the trust in you that we need to be healers and reconcilers, because that's who you've created and called us to be. Hear now names of people that we raise to you. These may be people who are hurting, people maybe that we've wounded, people that we have a hard time forgiving. Hear these names that we bring to you, Lord. This and everything else that we pray in the name of our crucified and risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
At that very hour, some Pharisees came and said to him, "Get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you." He said to them, "Go and tell that fox for me, 'Listen, I am casting out demons and performing cures today and tomorrow, and on the third day I finish my work. Yet today, tomorrow, and the next day I must be on my way, because it is impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem.' Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. See, your house is left to you, and I tell you, you will not see me until the time comes when you say, 'Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
What is a prophet? I think we tend to think of prophets as someone who can look into the future and can predict the future, like these crazy people hovering over crystal balls who can see into what is coming and then is able to predict it, like a tarot card reader. For the past month, we've been talking about the minor prophets in our Graceways class during the month of February. And we discovered that prophets aren't people who predict the future. There's some key aspects to prophets that we need to understand. A prophet is not somebody who predicts the future, but somebody who speaks the truth. Somebody who simply says what is. And often what accompanies that is the outcome. So like if I were to say, if you continue to drive at 150 miles an hour on the interstate, you're going to get in a crash and you're probably going to die. It's not because I'm predicting the future. It's seeing the truth and being honest about the outcome of those truths. So it's not a prediction of the future. It's being honest. It's being truthful. The other thing that we noticed in all the prophets, so the prophets are always speaking to the powers that be and how those powers are oppressing the others. It happens every time. Whenever we hear those hard words of the prophets, it's always against Israel, who is not doing exactly what it should, or Judah, the southern kingdom, that is not following in the ways of God, that they've lost their way. And whenever it's a positive prophecy, whenever it's a positive thing, it's because the people are in exile, or they're sent away, or they're being persecuted. So the positives are not against the powers of Israel, it's against those powers that are oppressing Israel and the people of God. Prophecy always speaks truth to power. Why? Because we have an addiction to power. We want to be in control. We like to have power. We want power around us. We surround ourselves with power. We clothe ourselves in power. And sometimes we get so clothed in it, we think it's owed to us, that our power is something we're supposed to have. And then we get fearful. What happens if someone takes our power? What happens if I become less powerful? What happens if someone removes this right or that freedom or this individual? And so we get ourselves so bound up in holding on to, afraid of what might happen, that the prophets then speak and say, power does not belong to you. It belongs to God. Jesus, in our text today, he has this word of great empathy. I imagine him, I've been to Israel, I imagine him standing on the hill on the other side of the great Hinnon Valley into Jerusalem and just weeping for the city and saying, Jerusalem, oh Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and who stone those who are sent to you, how I long just to gather you up like a hen gathers her brood under her wings, yet you will not let me. There's a long history of people in Israel who don't want to hear the truth. We read about Micah. It was a time in Micah when the kingdoms were very powerful and very strong, full of riches, and they had great houses of gold, and they were like at the pinnacle of what they were called to do. And Micah says, you've missed your way. God doesn't desire for great riches. God does not desire for great feasts. God, you call these things blessings, but in the midst of you calling them blessings, you've actually seen how you've harmed others. That Micah says, I don't want your feasts. I don't want your sacrifices. I don't want thousands of rivers of oil and rams and even your firstborn. I don't want these sacrifices. What I want for you to do is to do justice, to do the right thing, to live out of loving kindness, to have a mercy and compassion and a chesed to the poor and the oppressed that you have oppressed in order for you to be rich, and to walk humbly with God, to know your place, to be below God, to be at the foot of God, so that God is telling you what is right and wrong, rather than you telling God what God is supposed to believe. Or Amos, who sees they're full of all of these riches and wealth, and says, you are like cows of Bashan, these great hills where the cows have eaten so much, they're heavy and fat, and yet it says, you have sold the needy for a pair of shoes. And says, what the Lord really requires, it's for justice to flow down from the hills, from righteousness to flow through the people like an everlasting stream, righteousness of God. They've lost their way. Jonah, we spoke of Jonah. And by the way, Jonah's the worst prophet in the world. And Jonah speaks a word of repentance to the great city of Nineveh, the Assyrians, their deep, dark, arch rivals, and says, repent. And when the Ninevites do repent in the story of Jonah, Jonah's mad. And he's mad at God. Jonah actually says, I knew you would do this because you are slow to anger and abounding with steadfast love. Jonah literally did not want kindness and peace and hope for his enemies. Even in Zechariah, one of the prophets we did, Zechariah speaks of the people all gathered together afterwards and this great day of God coming and restoring. The name Zechariah actually means God remembers, that God remembers the people that were in oppression in Babylon and are now being restored to home, but they have forgotten to put God first and they fixed their own houses before they fixed the temple. They put their own needs again in front of God. And in every single one of these prophets, there's usually a little story in the middle of it, where the kings and the other prophets, so the kings in their courts would have these prophets that would come and they would, the prophets would say all the things that the kings would want them to say. They would say, oh, God is blessing us. God clearly wants these things. You know, if God didn't want these things, then we would have all fallen dead to the ground. And when Amos and Micah speak to them, they tell Amos and Micah to be quiet and to be silenced. Don't say these words. Don't say these words. Because the truth is too hard to hear. We don't want to hear the truth. And you're actually asking us to remove power out of our lives. So be quiet, hush, leave our cities, they say. Go back south, they say. But the truth of God is not something that can be silenced. Jesus says, oh, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets, Jerusalem, the center of power, the place that God is supposed to dwell on Zion. You kill those sent to you to bring the message of God to you. You kill them. I think I've been thinking a lot about all the things happening in our world right now. And I find myself just really struggling with needing to speak a prophetic word, a truth in this moment. That when we get ourselves into a place where we can't hear true things, that we have to be very careful. That we have to recognize that the Jerusalem maybe that we've had in our lives has at times been the church, the very place that God is supposed to dwell. The church has been a weapon used against other people. It has been used to divide. It has been used to send people to war, for power grabs. It's been used to keep people out of God's favor. That the church, the place of God's great gift of grace and wholeness and holiness, that the church has been used to wound others. People right now are saying in the name of Jesus that LGBTQ youth should be isolated and unsafe and shamed. And they're saying that in the name of Jesus. The truth is that God claims every one of us as a child of God, and every last soul on this planet is claimed as that child. And anyone who speaks any other thing is not speaking the word of God. That is a prophetic word. We see right now war is happening in the Ukraine. And let's call it for what it is. It is a power grab. It is a land grab. And it is people using their energies and weapons at their hands to harm and to take from others. God knows that the poor and the oppressed are those most harmed in these situations. And those who want to justify Ukraine's violence against the other, there's no space for that. God's word has always been for the poor and the oppressed and against power. And we have to admit, we have to acknowledge that the church has been a place of power. Ever since Constantine said the church is going to be the center of the Holy Roman Emperor, the church has been at the center of power. And we have not always been kind with that. And we, you and me, siblings in Christ, we have inherited these wounds. We've inherited the wounds that we have caused to others. We've inherited the preaching from pulpits that told people that people of color are just objects worthy of being bought and sold and not treated as human. We've inherited that. We've inherited places like Red Cloud School at Pine Ridge, which was a school that essentially kidnapped indigenous children, put them into school and taught them how to act like white people, trying to expunge their culture and did it all in the name of Jesus. We've inherited those wounds. Just this past week, I saw a thing online where a person, how do I put this? A person, I believe, who kneels at the idol of nationalism and not Jesus. He put into Jesus' mouth that Jesus' enemies are the immigrants. And a person right below saying, you're the reason why I'm not a Christian anymore. It's because we've used Jesus as a weapon to demonize and to harm. Right now, America is the most powerful country in the world. We have gobs of resources, gobs of money, gobs of power. I wonder if there's a word for us that Jesus is sharing. Us, the church, us, to say, oh, church, my church, you who kill those who bring truth to you and who stone those who are sent to you, how I want to draw you in, but you won't let me. That somehow we've left Jesus out of the building and have fallen to the idols the same way that it happened in Micah and Amos and Jonah and all the other prophets. During this time of speaking of being wounded, we can talk about those wounds that we have in this time, and that's so true. But we're going to also have to address the woundedness of others, in particular the woundedness that we've inherited, this long genealogy of generations of people who have been Christ followers who have harmed others, that we have to acknowledge and address those harms and say something about them and do something true for them. We have to live as people of justice. We have to figure out how to do as Micah says, which is to walk humbly with God, to sit at God's feet, to live out of loving kindness, mercy, and compassion, and to do the right thing, to do justice, which is to begin by saying, we repent. We repent for all the ways that we have harmed others. We repent for the ways we've used things like communion to keep people out of God's love. The ways that we've used the cross as a weapon against others to say, you are out and you are in. The way that we've used Christ's church to keep people poor by taxing them. For generations, for hundreds of years, we did this. We have to repent. We have to acknowledge those wounds. Is that a true word for you today? Is it hard to hear? I know it's hard for me to speak. It's hard because those are my wounds too. I have been a perpetuator of those wounds too. It starts by hearing a word of truth from Jesus. Jesus who calls us, who says, I'm wounded for your sake. That Jesus, who is a culmination of the prophet's words, that God will remember, God's promises will not be forgotten, and God will constantly call us home and claim us. And not if, but when we admit the truth that we need God, then the healing for our wounds and the wounds of others can truly begin. So let us be honest. Let us do justice. Let us love kindness. Let us walk humbly with God. Let us welcome the prophets back in our lives. If you'll pray with me. Lord God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, on paths as yet untrodden through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out in good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. In the name of Jesus, amen.
In this quiet place, in this quiet place, help me be still and know. quiet place. In this quiet place, help me be still and know.
This year, we are doing confession and forgiveness a bit differently. You see, God has already forgiven us, and so we'll be living into who we are as children of God by acknowledging our shortcomings and then setting them aside so that we can live as fully loved people. So we invite you to participate in this exercise as you're comfortable, knowing that our ability to enter into contemplative spaces in this exercise will be different for everyone. We're all on our own journeys. And so if you get antsy or distracted as I lead us through a meditative way of acknowledging our shortcomings and setting them aside, simply acknowledge that in yourself. Just say, wow, I got distracted, and then enter back into this practice. And if this is new to you, we invite you to just try. Just join in with us and see what might come up. So in a moment, I'll be inviting you to enter into this space of reflection, bringing to mind areas where you've fallen short this week. Perhaps something you've been carrying around since it happened. It's been weighing on you. Or maybe symptoms of a cycle of behavior that you are already aware of that you just can't seem to quit. Perhaps it's something that you've been shoving aside, afraid to acknowledge, that God wants to bring to light for you today. One example I have of experiencing shame and falling short is when I was drinking a coffee I'd purchased at a coffee shop and I drove past someone who was experiencing homelessness. Instead of smiling, waving, seeing if I had something to offer them, I looked down and I avoided them, increasing the distance between us. As we mentally acknowledge these shortcomings, we will stack them up and set them aside, removing their power over us. So I invite you to make a visual in your mind of stacking up these shortcomings, whether they be rocks or books or post-it notes, and then I'll invite you to set them aside. Please center yourself now, putting away distractions, shifting in your seat till you are comfortable, setting your feet on the floor so you can feel held by the earth. Gently close your eyes or soften your gaze and begin to notice your breath. Notice your breath. As you feel your chair support you in the same way that God holds each of us every day, center in on just this moment. Breathing in and out, we invite you to slow down your body and focus on your breath. Together, we will acknowledge our mistakes. We'll visualize the ways we have fallen short, the actions we wish we would have taken, something we wish we had not done, something we were not able to do. And as you visualize your mistakes, we invite you to acknowledge them by reciting in your head, I see that I made a mistake. Or maybe, I see I could have shown up better. And then set them aside. We invite you now to recite this process in your mind as each shortcoming comes up. I see that I made a mistake. I see that I could have done better. I see that I made a mistake. I see that I could have done better. And as you stack your mistakes, the ways that you've acted out of your wounds, remember that we all have our own stacks, that we are in this together. And now we invite you to stare at your pile of missteps. We're going to leave them here so that we can live without the burden of carrying them around. I invite you to mentally kick over the pile, maybe give them wings to fly away, maybe let them dissolve pixel by pixel, or simply walk away. Now that you've destroyed your pile, we invite you to center back in on your breath, trusting that the rhythm of life will carry you forward and receive this good news. People of God, each and every one of us is a forgiven and loved child of God. You are released from the grip of your shortcomings, from where you have acted out of your wounds, and freed to live life as a child of God, created to experience everything in the fullest, to have joy, to have love, to be loved, to love others, and to care for creation. We invite you now to come back into your space, wherever you are, to start shifting around in your seat. Gently open or refocus your eyes and return to your regular breathing. An important part of living as followers of Christ is that we do not do it alone. So, forgiven and beloved children of God, we invite you to share God's peace with one another, to greet each other and celebrate each other and the presence you have in your life. So get out your phones, hug those around you, send text messages, or make a note to call someone later to celebrate our siblings in Christ that we get to do life with as forgiven children of God. May the peace of Christ be with you.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." As God's family, we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You know, that last phrase that we say in the Lord's Prayer, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, that's actually not in the prayer. That's actually not in the Bible. When Jesus taught his disciples to pray, that part wasn't included. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. I had a professor who taught that Jesus wouldn't have said it that way. He would have said, for ours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. You see, God's reign is to be shared. God doesn't keep everything to God's self. God doesn't just say everything's mine and holds it to God's self. God shares life and pours God's self out for the sake of all and lets us use whatever we want. We can use these trees however we want to use them. We can use the water how we want, the air how we want, but God hopes that we'll take care of everything. We often feel a need to hold on to power in our lives. We think the power is going to protect us, and often we want to have power over others, and all it does is create harm. So what if we see this meal as the first step in how we share life together? We're not here to hoard. We're not here to be selfish. We're not here to see that everything is for me. We're here to share. We're here to be part of one another, to use all that we have so that everyone may have life. When we invite all to the table, the reason we're doing that is we're demonstrating that we bear a responsibility to make sure no one is hungry today. No one is lonely today. No one is left out today. No one is pushed to the edges today. Because all of us belong to God. We're all siblings in Christ. So, you're welcome to eat. I hope you'll share your food with whoever is in the room with you, because we know that the gifts of God are free. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. And now as we are sent into the world, know that you are a child of God. Our wounds may remind us of our brokenness, but through God's grace, we are set free to create new ways to choose love and hope in every moment. Love God, serve God. Love all, serve all. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.